بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا وإن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We commence our class tonight, inshallah, with the recitation of the first 10 verses of Surah Al-Kahf as we become accustomed. We'll start, inshallah, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثار من لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا وإنا لجاعلون ما عليها صعيدا جرزا أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. صدق الله العظيم. صدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. We'll commence, inshallah, tonight with the 19th verse of Surah Al-Kahf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes us further into the story of the companions of the cave. And we mentioned last week, we spoke about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created for them the necessary facilities so that they are able to stay alive for this entire duration that they spent in the cave. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put certain elements in place for them, both from within themselves and from the outer creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sun and the dog, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned their bodies from one side to the other side in order to facilitate for their safe coming and their safe return to this life after the long sleep. And we mentioned that the last verse that we did was where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the companions, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you had to look at them, لَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِرَارًا وَلَمُلِئْتَ مِنْهُمْ رُعْبًا, you would run away from them and you would turn back out of fear and out of awe for them. And we mentioned that while a person usually first becomes fearful, and then as a result of the fear he starts running away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first spoke about running away and about turning around, As, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the fear, the latter part of the verse. And we mentioned that the waw, ya wala, the wala muli'ta minhum ru'ba, the waw there, does not refer to a specific sequence, but rather it refers that both elements had been found in the person that was to enter upon them, that was to peep and see them. He would both become fearful and he would turn away and he would run away from them. And it reminds me of a verse in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the mushrikeen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالُوا مَا هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا. Now we know that the mushrikeen, أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا مُنْكِرِينَ لِلْبَعْثِ. The mushrikeen, they never believed in ba'ath, which is the resurrection. Allah ta'ala was not to resurrect them, and they were not to live after they died. There's no life after death. So Allah Ta'ala says, وَقَالُوا مَا هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا. If one translates it, they say, this is but our dunya life, نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا. We die and then we live. We die and then we live. وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ. And we will not be resurrected. So if one was to take that the waw refers to specific sequence, then it would not make sense Allah Ta'ala mentioning first the death and then the life. Because dying entails, according to their belief, that they will die and they will never stand up again, they will never live again. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا. We die and then we will live again. It does not mean, وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ. We will not be resurrected. That would mean that the ayah does not make sense. Because they would live and they would die and they would not be resurrected. That would be the sequence. So therefore the waw here does not refer to a specific sequence. What it means is, نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا. We will live and we will die. وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ. We will not be resurrected. Although Allah Ta'ala has put the death before the life, but it does not refer to a specific sequence. It means that they will, both elements will be existent. They will live for a period of time. They will eventually die. And once they die, their life will come to an end. طيب. Tonight, inshallah, we continue with the 19th verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وكذلك بعثناهم ليتساءلوا بينهم قال قائل منهم كم لبثتم قالوا لبثنا يوما أو بعض يوم قالوا ربكم أعلم بما لبثتم فبعثوا أحدكم بورقكم هذه إلى المدينة فلينظر أيها أزكى طعاما فليأتكم برزق منه وليتلطف ولا يشعرن بكم أحدا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and similarly and likewise, بعثناهم, we caused them to rise up again and we rose them, ليتساءلوا بينهم, so that they may question among themselves. قال قائل منهم, one of them said, or one person amongst them said, كم لبثتم, how long did you spend? قالوا لبثنا يوما أو بعض يوم. The rest answered and they said, we spent a day or a part of a day. قالوا ربكم أعلم بما لبثتم. Another one said, ربكم, your Lord best knows how long you spent in the cave. فبعثوا أحدكم بورقكم هذه إلى المدينة. فبعثوا, send أحدكم, one of you, بورقكم هذه, with this coins of yours, to the city. فلينظر, let him see, أيها أزكى طعاما, which of the food that he can find is the purest and is the best. فليأتكم برزق منه, and let him bring some of that sustenance or some of that food for us. وَلْيَتَلَطَّفْ, and let him be cautious. وَلَا يُشْعِرَنَّ بِكُمْ أَحَدًا, and let not anybody become aware of you, or let not anyone become aware of you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then after they've slept for the 300 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had instructed that they stand up and they wake up from their sleep. And when they woke up, they looked at one another, And they looked at the sun outside, so the one asked the question, he said, come Nabi, how long did you sleep? Well, there was no time, there was no watches, there was no calendars. So usually if you wake up in the morning, that's the first thing you look at the time. There's no time. The only time that you could possibly judge was the sun. So they looked at the sun. So they said, لَبِثْنَا يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمًا. Spent about a day or part of a day. They went in the beginning of the day. And when they woke up, it was towards the end of the day. The sun was busy setting. So they said, looks like a day or part of a day. Maybe we slept the entire day. Or maybe just part of the day, one part of the afternoon. And then one of them responded and says, قَالُوا رَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثْتُمْ. You were asleep. You really do not know how long you were asleep. It could be a day, it could be part of a day, it could be maybe a bit longer than that. Allah best knows how long we sleep. Indicating that how long they slept was not important. And they realized this. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. They are a group of youngsters that believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by virtue of their belief and the iman, it was not important or significant to them how long they slept, but rather what they went to the cave for. They went to the cave to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when there was difference of opinion amongst them, how long they slept, one of them stood up and said, رَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثْتُمْ. Remember, Allah knows best. Don't enter into unnecessary debates and unnecessary arguments as to how long we sleep. Allah knows. Let it be. Allah knows how long we sleep. More important now is we're feeling a bit hungry. We're feeling a bit hungry, so we need to eat. As you're sleeping for 300 years, la ilaha illallah. So they're very hungry. So what? They gather the coins and they say, فَبَعَثُوا أَحَدَكُمْ بِوَرِقِكُمْ هَذِهِ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ. One of you go and you select one of them, go to the city and go purchase for us some food. Go purchase for us some food, but be careful. Remember why we left the city. We left it so nobody can notice us. We're in the cave and we do not want to be disturbed when worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So go to the city, be cautious. Don't attract too much attention and look for some good food, some halal food that you can eat, and let nobody become aware of you. So some of the lessons that we can learn here is that فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَيُّهَا أَزْكَى طَعَامًا. They're extremely hungry. Extremely hungry. But yet the importance of seeking halal and طَيِّبًا, sustenance that is halal and that is also pure, أَزْكَى, most pure, is important. There's a difference between halal and between طَيِّب. طَيِّب is a sustenance that is halal, means it meets the minimum requirements of a food. For a person to be able to, a Muslim to be able to consume it, it meets the minimum requirement. Tayyib is a food that is tayyib. It is a food that is halal, and over and above it is also pure. As we would call it wholesome. But wholesome in terms of, I'm not speaking about healthy food and the herbs and those. I'm speaking about food that has been prepared by people who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I remember some time ago speaking to one of the ulama. He's from the UK. And he mentions to me and he says that if one really builds up your spirit, you build up yourself spiritually, you will be able to taste the difference between food that is prepared by a disbeliever and a food that is prepared by a believer. Because a person that prepares, a Muslim that prepares the food, what is he going to do when he puts in the ingredients? Bismillah. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Rasulillah. So he prepares the food with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a part of the slaughtering, it needs to be according to Sharia, ala hasab al مذبوح حسب الطريقة الإسلامية والشريعة الإسلامية, which is slaughtered according to the minimum specific requirements of Sharia. A part of the meat that must not be tainted and mixed with swine or with khinzir. A part of the ingredients of the food, they should not contain alcohol and other things that are non-permissible. is also another element, that spiritual element to the food. And that adds, that spiritual element to the food affects the spiritual being of the person who consumes the food. So he gave me an example. And to be honest, I haven't really taken heed of it yet. But he says, if you were to, for example, use the month of Ramadan, and you see the month of Ramadan, usually one consumes, you eat your wife's food, your mother's food, even the English people who are Muslim eat the food. He says the first time that you consume of that food that was prepared by a non-Muslim, just feel a difference that it has, different effect it has in your spirituality. Allah Ta'ala alone knows with regards to that. But yes, there is a significance to food that is prepared by a person who fears Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And this is the secret of why Imam Ash-Shafi'i rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, when going to the house of Imam Malik, when he ate from the food, he ate a lot. And his daughter noticed this, and one of the questions that she asked him in the morning was, my father speaks about you in high regard, and we know that the person should eat should eat a third of his portion of his stomach for the food, keep a third for the water, and a third for him, for his space and the air to breathe. But we notice that you've eaten considerably amount of food, perhaps over your third that you were supposed to eat. So Imam Shafi'i said, yes, the reason for that is that the food has been prepared by a generous person. And the food of a generous person and a believer is a cure for myself. So this is the ta'aman, azka ta'aman, the purest of food. So we don't just want any food, we want azka ta'aman. Bring us the best of food. The food that you know that is a person that fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِيَتَلَطَّحْ But don't forget, while you're busy looking for this food, because we know it's not going to be easy. We came out of a township where most of the people did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who perhaps did believe, they did not believe openly. So whilst you are going to be in search of this food of yours, the purest of food, don't attract unnecessary attention. And cause, let not anybody become aware that you are in the area, because you know that the king is looking for us. Before we get to the next verse, another beauty, a beautiful term that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used here, we also can extract a lesson, is فَلْيَأْتِكُمْ بِرِزْقٍ مِّنْهُ The ba'ya refers to a portion of the sustenance. Bring for us some of the food, some of the purest food bring for us. And the scholars here speak about this بِرِزْقٍ مِّنْهُ that two words there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lays down an important principle when one enters the marketplace. That you enter the marketplace with the aim and the intention that you are going to buy that which suffices you for your needs. Not, just that which suffices me. You could have said, bring a Gatsby and bring us a steak sandwich and bring us a pizza. No, you just said, bring. Birizqin means bring some sustenance for us. Bring some risk that will be enough to suppress our hunger. If we can continue living for another day.
إنهم إن يظهروا عليكم يرجموكم أو يعيدوكم في ملتهم ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا. If they indeed يظهروا عليكم, if they become aware of you, يرجموكم, they will stone you. أو يعيدوكم في ملتهم, or they will return you back to their religion. ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا, and never will you become successful again. And here the companions of the cave, they indicate to the person who's going to the marketplace the importance that he maintains very cautious in his movements, because if it is that the king, the Qiyanos, was to become aware of them, then he would come to the cave, he would follow them, he would trace them, and once he gets them, he's going to kill them. For they stood up against him.
They stood up against him when he asked him, why is it you believe? You don't believe in me. So they said, Rabbuna, إِذْ قَامُوا. When they stood up, they opposed the king. They said, Rabbuna, رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. You are not our Lord. These idols are not our Lord. You can't worship them. Our Lord is the Lord of the samawat and the earth, the heavens and the earth. لَن نَدْعُوَ مِنْ دُونِهِ إِلَهَ. We will never ever worship any other ilah but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَيَا رَبِّ ثَبِّتْنَا عَلَى الْحَقِّ وَالْهُدَى وَيَا رَبِّ اِقْبِضْنَا عَلَى خَيْرِ مِلَّةٍ. Oh Allah, keep us steadfast on the truth and on guidance. And oh Allah, اِقْبِضْنَا عَلَى خَيْرِ مِلَّةٍ. Allow us to die on the best religion to you, to the deen of Islam. And this is an indication that the most valuable thing that a person, a believer has is his belief, is his iman. His iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something which one or she cannot compromise. And if one compromises his deen, then there's no good in the person. His wealth can be compromised, his positions can be compromised, but his deen, his iman, his faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ought never to be compromised.
وكذلك أعثرنا عليهم ليعلموا أن وعد الله حق وأن الساعة لا ريب فيها إذ يتنازعون بينهم أمرهم فقالوا بنوا عليهم بنيانا ربهم أعلم بهم قال الذين غلبوا على أمرهم لنتخذن عليهم مسجدا.
الله سبحانه وتعالى says, and similarly, likewise, we caused people to be informed about them. لِيَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ. So they may know that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is haqq, is the truth. وَأَنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا. And that the last hour is no doubt it's going to come. It's inevitable. لَا مَفَرَّ مِنْهُ. There's no running away from it. وَلَا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. And there's no asylum towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except to Allah. There's no asylum from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except seeking asylum in Allah. The only person that can give you shelter, the only being that can give you asylum, the only being that can give you refuge is Allah. La ilaha illallah.
وكذلك أحضرنا عليهم. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the companions of the cave to be noticed. People became informed about them. How did they become aware of them?
After the one person, one of the companions left the cave, he enters the city. But as he enters the city, he sees there are writings on the doors of the city and on the walls of the city, indicating that this is, they believe in Allah. This is ajib, this is strange. We slept a day or part of a day, and people started believing in Allah in one day. This happened. So he enters the city. As he enters the city, he sees certain things look different. After 300 years, it's definitely going to look different. Because the people that went for Hajj in 1960, and the people that killed 2014, there's a big difference. Big difference between the two. I think if we see the portraits of Makkah in the, when was the flood in the 60s? In the 1960s. The flood, you look at photos of the flood and you see how the mataf, the surroundings of the Kaaba, looks completely different as what it looks today. So, and that is not even 100 years, 40 years later. Imagine about 300 years. So he looks and he sees it. And right down, he looks at the people, most of them are not familiar, nevertheless. He thinks to himself, perhaps I'm just not familiar with this portion of the town. He enters and he starts looking for some food. Eventually comes across a person who's selling food, gives him the money and he says, I want to purchase some of this food. And he gives him the money, the person looks at the coin, looks at him. Where did you get this money from? He says, we don't deal with this money. He says, how do we even deal with this money? I just bought now. 2 days ago I bought something from this very same money. I actually don't deal in this money. Are you the only person that don't deal in this money? I should perhaps go to another shop. She says, no, this is A long time. I don't even recognize this. I don't even recognize. Where did you get this? He says, this is my money. You know that we've been using all the time. You must have found a treasure. You must have found a treasure 300 years ago. Imagine if someone was to come to myself or to yourself and purchase some goods with some shillings and some pennies that were in circulation in the 1800s, which is worth perhaps quite a bit of money nowadays. You must have found a treasure. Where did you get this money? This money is not in circulation any longer. He says, oh, I need to take you to the Mayadukan. Either one of two things, you found the treasure, or there's something that you're hiding. He says, no, you need to go to the Mayadukan. Why do you want to go to the... He needs to be cautious. People must not become aware. When here all of a sudden, the opposite is happening. People are becoming informed of مَكَذَٰلِكَ أَثَرْنَا عَلِمْهُمْ. So whilst they were cautious in what they were doing, Allah Ta'ala had other plan for them. Allah wanted to use them as a lesson for nations and nations and generations after them to come until the end of time. Look at this. Youngsters, the sacrifice that they made, and look, Allah Ta'ala's aid, Allah Ta'ala aided them. Nothing is impossible for Allah. And then he goes to the mayor. The dealer says that, pay you this money. He says, this is his own money. I'm telling him that he must have found a treasure. He's insisting that this is his money. He just purchased a few days ago. He purchased from this. So the person tells him, where did you get this money? The mayor says, he says, no, this is my money. This is our money. We've been using it all the time. We've been using it now for the past, just not too long, a few days ago we used it. She says, who are you? What's your name? He mentions his name. Who's your family? The mayor says, but I don't know any of these people that you're mentioning. He says, my father is this person. My grandfather is this. And my brothers and my sisters, they're well known in the community. She says, I don't know any of these people. What is your story? So he says, no, our story is that, you know, we went to a cave. We took shelter into the cave because we were afraid of the king. And we came to the marketplace now to purchase some food and try to be cautious, but now it seems as we're inevitably going to fall into the hands of the king. So he says, what king are you speaking of? So he mentions the name of the king, the Qiyanus. 300 odd years ago that you're speaking about. 300 odd years. Possible. Doesn't feel like 300 odd years. How can it be 300 odd years? I'm exactly the same as I am. And then when he mentioned to him the story, he said, remember some stories that came down in the generation, some fairy tales that were mentioned of a group of youngsters that ran away from the king because they ran away with their religion and they were never ever found after that. So he says, yes, that is us. So he says, how can it be? It was so long ago, you're still alive today. He was self-confused and said, take me to your friends. Go to the friend and you meet each and every one of them. And you start realizing the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The power of Allah, that coin was not in circulation, was a coin that was dated 300 years ago as evidence that they lived in that time, and they were able to describe the city, the people of the city. They were able to describe the king, and they were able to describe the people around the king as well. So they called them, they went to the king, they said, a strange thing just happened now. And we just met people, youngsters that say that they lived in the town that we know 300 years ago, and they're in a cave. So the king says, I need to meet them. But before the king meets him, the youngster enters the cave and tells him, is there food that you're supposed to bring for? He says, no, I've got something more interesting for you than food. Do you know that we were sleeping here for 300 years? The people in the cave themselves did not know. We were sleeping here for 300 years. I went out to the market and I told him the whole story. Eventually, there the king came. The king came and he met them. The king met them, the king honored them, and he brought him the necessary food that they required. And the king was, by that time, he was a believer. And then all the followers of him were also believers. And after honoring them, meet them, they left the cave, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them to, at that moment, Allah ta'ala forgives them, and they died in the cave. And when that happened, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَحْفَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ. Similarly, we cause people to become aware of them and know them, so that they may know that Allah's promise is true. Allah's promise is true. Despite all what the king in the time, in his kingdom, what he claimed to believe and what he claimed to be truth, Allah's promise is true. They were sincere with Allah, they were truthful to Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that he would aid them, and Allah ta'ala aided them. وَأَنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا. In the same manner that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was able to bring them back after 300 years, remember that the final hour inevitably is also going to come. And Allah is able to bring it anytime. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا. There's no doubt about it. إِذْ يَتَنَازَعُونَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَمْرَهُمْ. So they disputing between them, among themselves, about the affair, of the companions of the cave. فَقَالُوا بِنُوا عَلَيْهِمْ بُنْيَانَ. They said, build a bunyan, build a structure, عليهم, above them. قال الذين غلبوا على أمرهم. Those who prevailed in the affair said, لنتخذن عليهم مسجدا. We will take a masjid by them. We will build a masjid, we will put up a masjid close to them. This verse, جماعة المسلمين, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about what happened after the companions of the cave died. So the people saw, subhanAllah, they are the slaves of Allah, they are the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We really need to do something about this. So the disbelievers said, ibnu alayhim bunyana, build a structure under grave. So people, they said, قال الذين غلبوا على أمرهم. Those believers, they said, لنتخذن عليهم مسجدا. No, rather, we are going to build close to the gravesite, we're going to build a masjid, a place where we can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so our salah and our prayers and our supplication can be more likely to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it is in close proximity to the salihin. Some of the ulama say that the place of the a salih person is buried is a place where mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends in abundance more than other places. So when Allah ta'ala's mercy descends, and the salihin and the surroundings of the salihin, we build a masjid, we worship Allah, because that's where Allah's mercy is. That's where Allah Ta'ala has showed, yanshur lakum rabbukum min rahmatihi. That is the place where Allah Ta'ala spread His mercy for the people of the cave. Wa yuhayyi lakum min amrikum mirfaqa. That's where Allah Ta'ala made easy for the companions of the cave. So let's build a masjid here. Allah's mercy has been descending here for 300 years. So let's build a masjid here. We want that mercy of Allah to descend in this place. And this is some of the evidence. The jawaz, bina'ul masajid, bil-qurbi min kuburi salihin, also the permissibility of building a masjid close, in close proximity to the shrines and the tombs of the salihin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then further goes on, and Allah ta'ala says, سيقولون ثلاثة رابعهم كلبهم ويقولون خمسة سادسهم كلبهم رجما بالغيب ويقولون سبعة وثامنهم كلبهم قل ربي أعلم بعدتهم ما يعلمهم إلا قليل فلا تمار فيهم إلا مراء ظاهرا ولا تستفت فيهم منهم أحدا. They will say, سيقولون ثلاثة رابعهم كلبهم. Three and the fourth being the dog. ويقولون, and they say, خمسة سادسهم كلبهم. Five and the sixth being the dog. ويقول رجما بالغيب. Guessing about the unseen. They're taking a guess with regards to the ghaib, the unseen. وَيَقُولُونَ سَبْعَةٌ وَثَامِنُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. And they say seven. They are seven. وَثَامِنُهُمْ. And the eighth is the dog. قُلْ رَبِّي. Tell them, رَبِّي, my Lord, best knows بِعِدَّتِهِمْ, for the duration that they spend, مَا يَعْلَمُهُمْ إِلَّا, قُلْ رَبِّي أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ My Lord, this knows their number. مَا يَعْلَمُهُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ No one knows them but a few. إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ فَلَا تُمَارِ فِيهِمْ إِلَّا مِرَاءً ظَاهِرًا So do not. فَلَا تُمَارِ فِيهِمْ Do not argue about them إِلَّا مِرَاءً ظَاهِرًا Unless with clear proof and evidence. وَلَا تَسْتَفْتِ فِيهِمْ And do not inquire فيهم about them منهم with regards to them أحدا anybody. Something comes to mind except if you in the time of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab Sayyidina Umar he is one of the companions he makes a dua and he says اللهم اجعلني من عبادك القليل Oh Allah make me from your few slaves. This is اللهم اجعلني من عبادك القليل Oh Allah make me from your few slaves. So, Sayyidina Umar goes to him and he says, what kind of dua is this that you're making? Oh Allah, make me from your future. What's your Sayyidina speaking about? Okay. So he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, وَقَلِيلٌ مِنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ And very few of my slaves are thankful to me. So, oh Allah, make me of the few slaves. The few slaves are thankful to me. سَيَقُولُونَ When Allah ta'ala says, سَيَقُولُونَ They will say, in most In many occasions in the Quran, when we see Sayyiduna, it gives the impression that it is not necessarily the truth. And the opposite to that, or other than that, is the truth. So, for example, we find in the Quran, Allah Ta'ala says, Sayyiduna Sufaha min al-Nas, that the Sufaha, the ignorant of the people, they would say, Sayyiduna, am yaquluna sha'irun natarabbasu bihi rayban manun. Do they say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a sha'ir, is a poet? يَقُولُونَ مَتَاهُ وَيَقُولُونَ مَتَاهُ And they ask a silly question, مَتَاهُ When is the final hour? As if they being sarcastic, telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, مَتَاهُ When is the last hour? Almost like, the last hour is not going to come. قُلْ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونَ قَرِيبًا Tell them, perhaps it is very close. So when Allah Ta'ala says Sayyiduna, it gives impression as if it is a silly statement or a silly question that they were to make. Thalathatun, they say there are three and the fourth being the dog. So the Yahud and the Nasara, some of them they said no, it's three and the fourth is a dog, and some of them said no, it's five and the sixth one is the dog, and seven and the eighth is the dog. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ tell them, رَبِّي أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ Allah best knows how many of the companions are the table. And if we can pause here for a moment, the importance of this verse and what we can derive from this verse is that many a times we see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the entire story of the companions of the camp. From how they ran away, how they left the town, And up till that very moment when Allah Ta'ala caused the people to become aware of them, many things happened, beautiful things happened in the process. They left the people and they went into a cave, into asylum. Allah Ta'ala caused them to sleep and lessons. And Allah Ta'ala brought them back after 300 years. What is the question that someone asked? How many are there? If Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala wanted us to know, How many are the companions of the cave? Allah Ta'ala would have said exactly how many are there. But Allah Ta'ala did not say so. فَلَا تُمَارِ فِيهِمْ So do not debate with them إِلَّا مِرَاءً ظَاهِرًا Do not debate with them unless with clear proof. In other words, with the Qur'an. Remember at the beginning when we said how the verse of Surah Al-Kahf was revealed. We said that Surah Al-Kahf was revealed as a result of the Yahud of Medina when they sent The Utbah ibn Rabi'ah and Nadr ibn Harith to Medina. So they told the Yahud told him, ask your Prophet about three things. The first thing was asking about anybody remember? The first question was asking about the companions of the cave. The second question was about the Dhulqarnain, the king. That travel the east and the west. And the third question was the soul. Now, اسأله عن الروح. And if he answers you, then he's a prophet. If he does not answer you, then you can do with him whatever you want to. So that means that the Yahud already knew about the companions of the cave before the Muslimin knew about it. Not because otherwise, how would they be able to tell Quraysh that they need to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about the companions of the cave if they did not know about it? How were they to know about it? It also indicates that they knew about the Qarnayn and they knew about the soul because they had a book and they had a script before them. A script that said exactly the signs of the Prophet that was to come and the history of the previous nations. Remember then, those history were fabricated, the tahrif entered into, distortion entered into it. So you'd find as a result of it, many information which we would not find in the Quran. When we find stories in the Quran, one of the beauty of the stories in the Quran is that it is extremely concise. It is extremely concise. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights exactly what is important. So that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention means it is not important and it is insignificant to us. So don't go searching for this and for that. Allah ta'ala did not mention it. Allah ta'ala mentioned what we needed to know and the story that we will need to derive from this and the lessons that we can learn is everything within the story. So now don't go and ask, but now what kind of food did they buy? Did they buy salami or did they buy githri? Or don't go and ask, what kind of dog was it? Was it a pit bull or was it a great dane? And while it might seem as a joke, the reality is that there are people that need to ask such questions. And that's why Allah Ta'ala says, سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةُ الرَّابِعُونَ كَلَمْ. Tell them, قُلْ رَبِّ أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ. Tell them, Allah best knows that the number. Don't worry about how many they were. Worry about the lesson that Allah Ta'ala has placed in. Worry about if they were seven, and the most authentic opinion of the ulama is that they were seven and the eighth was the dog. Ibn Abbas says, أَنَا مِنَ الْقَلِيلَ الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ عِدَّتَهُمْ. I am from the few that knows how many the companions of the cave were, هُمْ سَبْعَةٌ وَثَامِنْهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. They are eight, and the eight is the dog. And on one other occasion, they asked Ibn Abbas, a discussion in the time of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, I think it comes in Tabarani. They asked Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab about Laylat al-Qadr. They asked Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab about Laylat al-Qadr. When is Laylat al-Qadr? And Sayyidina Umar been inquired by different Sahaba and it came to the time of Ibn Abbas. He said, when do you think? In terms of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, Imma li sab'in madain aw li sab'in baqin. Baqin. So Ibn Abbas had placed much significance on the number seven. He says it is either seven, it is either going to be on the night where there will be 7 days remaining of the month of Ramadan, or it will be on the night it will be 7 days that had passed from the last 10 days of the month of Ramadan, indicating it's either 23rd or the 27th night. So they asked, but why do you say so? He says, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah ta'ala created sab'a samawat wa min al-ardi mithlahun. Allah ta'ala created seven heavens and also seven layers of ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the 7 days of the week. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a human being in seven stages. His first turab, nutfa, alaqa, mudgha, idham, lahm, and then it's a full form. From clay until the full form, seven stages. And then he says what? And the food that Allah ta'ala speaks about, different forms of food in the Quran, Allah ta'ala speaks about in Surah Abbas, is seven different forms. فأنبتنا فيها حبا count with me فأنبتنا فيها حبا وعنبا وقضبا وزيتونا ونخلا وحدائق غلبا وفاكهة وأبا seven different things. حبا is grain وعنبا grapes وعنبا وقضبا vegetables وفاكهة فأنبتنا فيها حبا وعنبا وقضبا وزيتونا ونخلا and olives and dates or palm tree, the fruit of the palm tree, which is the dates, وحدائق غلبة and gardens, thick gardens and forests, وفاكهة and fruits, وأبا and grass. So these are different seven things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about in Surah Abbas. And what else? وَأُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَسْجُدَ عَلَى سَبْعَةِ أَعْظُمْ. Allah ta'ala instructed the Ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they perform sujood, they must perform sujood on seven limbs. What is the seven limbs? Naam? Those? Knees? Knees and forehead? Naam. Hadith comes in. Bukhari and Muslim. And then you have the tawaf. How many? Seven. The belting of the jamarat. Seven. The sa'i between Safa and Marwa. Then there were seven. There were seven people and the eighth one was a dog. Allah, final edit. So this is how he derived, and from based on analogy, derived the number that the companions of the Kaibah. Nevertheless, قُرْ رَبِّي أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ Allah Ta'ala best knows how many they were. مَا يَعْلَمُهُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ فَلَا تُمَارِ فِيهِمْ So don't go in unnecessary debates and arguments with them. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is placed in front of you of the story, that is what you take. And what if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has left, that's what you just leave on. Even if you look at the surah of Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam, surah Yusuf, it's a beautiful story. But with regards to the length of the story, it's still a concise story. You would find if someone was to write, if one takes for example a book, and one writes this about the story, or one looks at the book of the story of Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam, compared to the Quran, you would see the person writes a thick volume. Now if you look at the story of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, for example, in the Bible, or in the Torah, rather, and you look at it, you see it's a thick story compared to the story that of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam that comes in the Quran. It indicates that many things that were put in there that is not important, is insignificant. What Allah Ta'ala has told us in the Quran and the information that Allah Ta'ala has given us, mira'an zahira, it is clear evidence. It is true evidence. Evidence that you can derive a lesson from, evidence that you can base your life on, evidence that you can use as a life example for you to lead you through your life. وَلَا تَسْتَفْتِ فِيهِمْ And if it is that you want to ask, do not ask them regarding this, the questions of the Ashab al-Kahf. Do not ask them any questions, the Yahud. Instead, return back to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With this, inshallah, we will conclude the evening. And whilst I think we have perhaps a few minutes left, I was meaning to ask if there were any questions with regards to, we've completed the story of the companions of the cave now, and this is the end of the story. And we will continue with next week, inshallah, with the 23rd verse, inshallah. So are there any questions that anybody has? There are some indications with regards to the year. There should be some indications, but I'm not familiar with the year. There are some indications because the books of history speaks about it. In the time of the Qiyanus, there was a time limit set to it, but what happened was that there was a difference of opinion in which place it took. So because some people say it happened in Turkey, other people say it happened in Jordan. In Turkey, there's a similar cave that looks like the cave of the companions of the Ashab al-Kahf, and in Urdun is also a cave. Both of the caves has some of the characteristics that there's a possibility it could be either one of the two. Majority of the ulama, though, they say that it's the one in Jordan, but because these different caves, there would be a different time, but the exact date with regards to when it happened, I could check in with inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Anybody else? Nobody? Jazakumullah khair, and inshallah we will commence inshallah next week with the 23rd verse of Surah Al-Kahf. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahu bihamdik. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك